Hi, my name is Glenn Cantor. I'm a WM patient, watch and wait. I live in Bend, Oregon, where I like to bicycle and ski. I'm the Torch Science Editor, and I'm on the Scientific Advisory Committee. And it's my great pleasure today to introduce Dr. Stephen Treon. Dr. Treon is the director of the Bing Center for Waldenstrom's Macroglobulinemia at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, as many of you know. And he's a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. You've heard a lot about BTK inhibitors and ibrutinib and zanubrutinib today. His group actually was the one that he and his group discovered the biological basis for using ibrutinib for WM. So all of this we can thank him for. And then not only did they discover this in a scientific way, but they went on to perform a clinical trial to support the use of ibrutinib for WM patients, and they went on to receive the first FDA breakthrough approval for ibrutinib in WM. This was the first breakthrough that the FDA awarded in any cancer indication. So it's pretty amazing work. He's published extensively on topics in WM in over 400 peer-reviewed original reports, reviews, editorials, book chapters. What he's going to be talking about today is that he's been organizing the international workshops on WM since 2003. In recognition of his scientific work in WM, he's received numerous honors and awards, including the IWMF Foundation Achievement Award, the Robert A. Kyle Award for Contributions for WM, the Top Doctor Award in Boston, just to name a few. And even more importantly than that, he's a really genuinely compassionate and nice person. I think that's really important. He encourages researchers and physicians around the world to work together toward better understanding of WM, and he's an excellent mentor of young scientists. So, Steve?
Well, hello. Thank you, Glenn, for those very generous words. And it's really a thrill for me to be here today. I was tasked with giving you an update on what took place at the 11th International Workshop on Waldenstrom's that took place in October of last year. And before I actually want to talk about that, I want to talk about the first International Workshop on Waldenstrom's. Which was held in Washington, D.C. We had 16 individuals who were actually present, including Judith May and Bob Kyle at this meeting. It was organized by Dr. Chesson, Bruce Chesson. And what we all agreed to were all the things that we didn't know about Waldenstrom's. And this, as we sat, all of us very, you know, caffeine deficient, watching a coffee maker at the NIH slowly drip, you know, coffee, hoping that there would be enough for 16 people. But that drip actually represented really where the state of affairs was for Waldenstrom's. It was slow in coming, and we really needed to accelerate progress. And some of that had to do with understanding the disease before we could actually move ahead and make the sort of innovations that we needed. And that really started with the second international workshop on Waldenstrom's. The IWMF played a very pivotal role in the organization of that meeting. By that point, we were up to about 40 people that had attended the workshop. And why that's important to say is this took place in 2002, and it was really where we first came up with the rule book for how to diagnose, manage, Waldenstrom's. And this resulted in a pivotal publication in the journal Seminars in Oncology, where we laid out these consensus panel reports on the diagnostic ways to go about diagnosing Waldenstrom's, what the sort of treatment modalities were that we all agreed as experts we ought to utilize, and then also the response criteria. How do we know if somebody's actually responding to their treatment. Now, since 2002, that rule book really hasn't been updated. Treatments have been updated, but a lot of the basic mechanics of how we go about diagnosing and assessing response did not occur until this meeting. And this is why I'm really very, very happy to share with you what occurred. There were, in fact, 7 consensus panels organized. A lot of experts volunteered their time to be part of these consensus panels. Some of them had over 30 members, you know, per panel. So it was a little bit like herding cats when you tried to get them all to, you know, deliberate and come up with their reports. In total, there were 670 people who took part in the 11th International Workshop. So contrast that to the 16 that we had, you know, at that first fateful meeting. So a lot has happened, and this is why I'm really happy to share with you all this progress. And I always believe, you know, that pictures are a nice way to reflect sort of the big community that is now built around this disease. This was the closing ceremonies that took place at the Prado Museum in Madrid. And we had, you know, many international experts that took part. The meeting was actually organized by myself and Chris Patterson, who's our administrative director at the Bing Center. And our local chairs included Dr. Ramon Garcia Sanz, who you see there depicted to the left. And next to me is Dr. Jesus San Miguel, these being all giants in the field of the plasma cell malignancies. There was very, very active discussion. This was a meeting that took part over 4 consecutive days. And in fact, when you think about that first meeting, which only was a matter of a few hours that we were all together, this was 4 days of continuous presentations, debate, consensus, you know, deliberations, and we still ran out of time. We just didn't have enough time. And think about the fact that there were almost 100 faculty presenters at this meeting. So just to show you what a great community we have. And these are just some of the photos. As you can see, it was a very much a packed audience for this meeting, and people were very attentive. They were very excited about the rollout of all the new data that was you know, being rolled out. And also with the virtual speakers, they played a very important, virtual speakers and virtual audience played a very important role in this meeting. Many from, fortunately, from other parts of, you know, the world couldn't make it, like the Chinese couldn't make it. Even though they're great contributors to the literature, they weren't allowed out of their country. And as a result, you know, many of them still participated virtually, but also presented virtually. So I'm going to take the next few minutes. Some of this will be fairly mundane because it's like reading out the law. But I do think, you know, I want to make some points about what each of these consensus panels, you know, focused on and what some of the outcomes of their deliberations were. The first one was actually consensus panel 1. This one had to deal with how to manage patients who had never been treated. They were treatment naive and symptomatic and required therapy. And this effort was led by my colleagues, Christian Buskey, who you will be seeing at the Ask the Doctor session tomorrow. Jorge Castillo, which I know all of you are very well familiar with from the US, and Judy Trotman from Australia. So you can see just from the other individuals that participated, this was quite an international a panel, you know, representing the U.S., Europe, Asia, as well as Australia. So what were the key points? And this is, I really mean to sort of gloss over these because there's a lot of, you know, footnotes that go with this. You know, the important take-home from this consensus panel is acknowledging that chemoimmunotherapy, such as dexamethasone, cyclophosphamide, Rituxan, you might know this as the DRC regimen, or bendamustine and Rituxan, still play a central role in the management of patients with Waldenstrom's. They represent, you know, well-tolerated fixed-duration therapies. But also the panel wanted to highlight the fact that we now have these new drugs, the covalent BTK inhibitors, such as ibrutinib, zanubrutinib, acalabrutinib, which are well-tolerated and perhaps, you know, better, you know, for use in people who might be unsuitable for chemoimmunotherapy. Unfortunately, the devil in the details is what the word unsuitable means. you're either too old to get chemotherapy or you're too young. And as all the oncologists get older, everybody gets younger. So I think that's a very important word, which comes back to the fact that this is where the dialogue, the patient shared decision making, plays a very important role. And I think as we've matured as a community, we've come to realize what an important role patients have in deciding their own fate. What was also acknowledged was the fact that we now had new data. You know, we had this large phase 3 trial called the Aspen trial, which gave us now a new second generation BTK inhibitor, zanubrutinib, which showed differences in toxicity in some cases, you know, with atrial fibrillation having far less atrial fibrillation and other side effects, and thus categorizing zanubrutinib as also a very suitable first-line therapy for the treatment of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. And I know you've seen this data before, but I want to say it is really unusual to see these large randomized trials occur in Waldenstrom's. This was the Aspen trial. There were two cohorts. The first one was about patients who had the MYD88 mutation, who either got zanubrutinib or ibrutinib. And the second cohort were those individuals that did not have the MYD88 mutation, and these patients went on and got zanubrutinib. And so what did we learn? Well, we learned that over time, both of these are very effective drugs. In fact, if you look at the major response rate, which is depicted here, at 44 months follow-up, this update was provided for the first time at the Waldenstrom workshop, you see that the major response rate is actually identical between these two drugs. But the depth of response numerically, not statistically significant, but numerically favored zanubrutinib. Another big surprise here was the fact that in those patients that had no MYD88 mutation, there was activity that was observed for zanubrutinib as a single agent, whereas the earlier studies that we had done did not, you know, show that with ibrutinib. There was also this difference in side effect profile, which was very notable. You saw, you know, far less atrial fibrillation associated with zanubrutinib. You know, if you look at all the categories of atrial fibrillation, 8% versus 23% for ibrutinib, and even the more severe versions of atrial fibrillation were far less. But there were also trade-offs. You know, you saw also, you know, more neutropenia associated with zanubrutinib, particularly at the severe level, compared to ibrutinib. And this is where, as you start navigating which of these drugs do I use, you start taking into account these fine points of management, the side effect profile, but also, as I'll show you in a little bit, the very important genomics. Now, you saw this very spirited debate between my colleagues, Dr. Mattis, as well as Dr. Ansel. I'm not sure who won. But I think what it does say is that both are great therapies. And let me actually show you the data that backs that up. Now, you may have seen this a little bit, you know, previous to this, but, you know, in collaboration with my colleagues at the Mayo, as well as in Europe, a number of centers, we all took part in this retrospective study. Now, when you use the word retrospective, there's always, you know, footnotes that say, you know, take it, but take it with a little bit of a grain of salt because it wasn't prospective. The chances of doing something prospective, meaning starting a study and then assessing people, you know, as they go on, it's really hard to do in a rare disease like ours. And so what did we learn from this study? Well, the data got coned down to just the MYD88 mutated individuals because it would be unfair to sort of compare ibrutinib's activity if you don't have the MYD88 mutation, as we said. So the bottom line is, you do get deeper responses with bendamustine-based therapy, but it doesn't translate into any benefit in terms of overall survival, but also progression-free survival. Progression-free survival, you'll hear me talking about this, PFS, progression-free survival, is the time that the disease is in check by a particular drug. So even this didn't differ. So what does that tell us? It tells us that both are equivocal. That, you know, if you're looking at sort of the long-term outcome, you know, both modalities, whether you use bendamustine or you use a BTK inhibitor, are going to produce similar outcomes, except that you have to then start weighing side effect profiles, short-term side effects, long-term side effects, which I think concern all of us. But there was one bit of important news that came out in Madrid, and this had to do with a mutation that you don't, probably most of you haven't heard about, Has anyone heard of TP53 mutations? If you have, please raise your hand. Okay, and I see a few, which is wonderful to see. So these are mutations that for the longest time we didn't pay attention to. Because when we did the frontline assessment in treatment naive patients, newly diagnosed patients, they were coming up at around 2%. And you know, when you see such a small number, you don't get excited. These mutations in other diseases, such as CLL and myeloma, are actually bad actors. You have this mutation, and these tumors tend to be more aggressive. But because our frontline studies done by us, as well as our French colleagues, showed them at such a low level, we didn't get excited. This is where BeiGene, I think, played a very important role, because as part of that Aspen study, they actually looked at all these molecular markers. And to our surprise, what they found is, though the rate of these TP53, nasty TP53 mutations was very low in treatment-naive patients, look at what happens in those patients that have actually received prior therapy. In fact, the rate goes up from 3% up to 22%. So almost a quarter of the patients now have these mutations. This was true, this increase, whether you had the MYD88 mutation or you had no MYD88 mutation. So let's study these patients a little bit closer. What did the previously treated patients actually see? This is actually from the paper that actually backed up the Aspen study and led to its approval. And that is that the vast majority of those previously treated patients got alkylator drugs like bendamustine and cyclophosphamide. Some of them also saw these nucleoside analog drugs, which can also be DNA damaging, such as fludarabine. So at the end of the day, when you're thinking about positioning these drugs, I think we need to, you know, really do the sort of work and investigation to keep in mind that some of these drugs actually create problems down the line. Maybe today they're producing sort of equivocal outcomes. But if in a large, you know, cohort of patients they're introducing these nasty mutations that may be bad actors down the line, we ought to sort of be thinking about this, how we position these relative drugs. And this turns out to be, I think, a very important practice point, which I'll come back to with one of the future consensus panels that address this. I also want to say that an important outcome of consensus panel one is to validate, when possible, check your MYD88 and your CXCR4 mutation status, because it does convey important diagnostic information. It helps the pathologist make the right call, but it also conveys important information around the outcome with several therapies for Waldenstrom. This was the Bruton-Ib study that Glenn earlier alluded to, just validating why these mutations are important. This is the long-term follow-up of that Bruton-Ib study. And you can see that, you know, depending on what your mutation status was, it actually indicated how long your therapy benefited you. Those patients that had only the MYD88 mutation, 70% were progression-free, meaning no progression of their disease at 5 years. It dropped down to 40% if they had both mutations. And if the patient had no MYD88 mutation, you can see that their disease progressed very, very soon. I won't get into the details, but even when we did our frontline study, same outcome. It takes longer to get into a remission if you have the CXCR4 mutation, and you can see here the difference. If you have the CXCR4 mutation, your disease tends to progress, you know, even earlier when you're using ibrutinib. Now, are there differences between the BTK inhibitors? And it does look like, even from an efficacy perspective, for those patients that have the CXCR4 mutation, and that's about 40% of all Waldenstrom patients, that in this long-term follow-up that we heard about in Madrid, those patients that got zanubrutinib actually did better. Their disease tended to be in check, you know, and controlled, you know, at a much higher rate than the patients who were on the ibrutinib arm. So as we think about these different BTK inhibitors, not only do we want to look at the side effect profile, but having, you know, their MYD88 status taken into account also is very important. Now let's talk a little bit about maintenance rituximab. This is a concept that's, you know, quite old. In fact, I chaired the first, consensus panel on the use of maintenance when rituximab first came forward. We were looking at this across many different B-cell malignancies. And I published a report, you know, years ago, another retrospective study that showed that patients who are on maintenance seemed to benefit, meaning that if they got therapy that included Rituxan, and they got more Rituxan over a period of time, usually about 2 years, that there was a benefit in terms of controlling the disease. At the meeting, we saw an update of the very important German study called the STILL study. And it was very interesting because in this study, the patients got bendamustine and Rituxan, and if they got a deep response, a major response, then they got randomized either to be observed or they got maintenance Rituxan, one single infusion every 2 months for 2 years. So what did this study actually show? Well, if you looked at the entire study, it showed no benefit, you know, in terms of adding maintenance Rituxan. But in an unplanned, and this is the important word, unplanned secondary exploration of the outcomes, those patients that were older than 65, on the other hand, did show this potential benefit to having maintenance Rituxan. So you will find, you know, among our community, people interpreting this data in different ways. You know, do we go by the original endpoint, which was to see how everyone did on the study, or do we go by this sort of breakdown in age? And the biology of the disease does differ between younger individuals and older individuals, so I do think this is important to keep in mind as we think about the use of maintenance Rituxan. I personally favor it and use it in the over 65 category. As I'm getting closer to 65, I'm really paying attention to the things that, you know, the doors that I want to keep open. But I do think, you know, this is an important modality of therapy. I also want to talk about one other key point that came out of, you know, consensus panel one, and that's when we think about the different effects of Waldenstrom's, we should also think about the way we treat. So take into account those patients that have Bing-Neel syndrome when the disease gets into the central nervous system. In the old days, we used to give high-dose chemotherapy. This was also something that I was particularly trained on by Bruce Chabner at the MGH, who actually invented this, you know, way to give high-dose methotrexate. But it was very toxic. You had to hospitalize patients, give it to them every 2 weeks, follow their methotrexate levels. A lot of things could go wrong. A lot of people had kidney failure as a result of it. Very, very bad. But, you know, one of the things that we did learn is ibrutinib does get into the brain. And as a result, we learned that, you know, you can actually use a drug like ibrutinib to actually treat patients who have central nervous system Waldenstrom's. And so this was one of the early publications that we had alluding to the activity. On the other hand, BTK inhibitors don't seem to work well for people that have amyloid. I'll talk a little bit about that in just a moment. But addressing the specific morbidity of how patients present was one of the important take-homes from consensus panel one. So let's move on to consensus panel two. This was an effort led by our friend Shirley Desa, who you just saw a few minutes ago, along with Jeff Mattis and Stathis Kastridis from Greece. So once again, take a look at the you know, panel here, and you recognize that it was truly an international panel. So what were the, you know, take-homes here? The take-homes here were you can think about chemoimmunotherapy, you can think about BTK inhibitors, but really the way you should judge which one, you know, you should use should be sort of looking at what the patient already had in their front line. If they saw bendamustine or they saw cyclophosphamide, then it's maybe time to think about a BTK inhibitor because these are very, very active drugs. And what you don't want to do is keep clobbering the patient with drugs that may affect those stem cells and damage their DNA and, you know, create problems down the line. The other really is to look at the specific way the patient is presenting. You know, think about what, you know, what you're treating specifically for their patient. Think about their biological age. Notice the word biological is used here. Think about all the things that also the other diseases that the patient may be presenting in choosing therapy. But also take note of the mutations here. Take note of the fact that TP53, that nasty mutation we talked about, now has been introduced into the lexicon here. Because, you know, if you're seeing that somebody got, you know, an alkylator drug like bendamustine or got, you know, cyclophosphamide, and they have the TP53 mutation, that's probably not the right therapy to reintroduce into the patient. And here, BTK inhibitors, and I'll show you some data in just a moment, may have a particular role for patients who are presenting with these bad mutations. Also to keep in mind when you're selecting therapies, look at the side effect profile, particularly for the BTK inhibitors. We talked about, you know, risk of atrial fibrillation. If their blood counts are low, you take that into account into which BTK inhibitor, you know, you use. Take into account, once again, you know, sort of the profile of what the patient has seen, but also be cognizant of the fact that there are now a lot of new drugs that are available for people that have already been previously treated, including the BCL2 inhibitors like venetoclax, which we're all very, very excited about. And most importantly, look at the last line here. Try to be in clinical trials when you can. This is the only way forward. It's a rare disease. We have a relatively small community, but it's a very powerful one. And it's because of these clinical trials that we've been able to make a difference. I just want to summate in this slide sort of the way we think about, you know, the BTK inhibitors. The first thing is to say we're blessed. I've actually had people, that I've cared for who, you know, had side effects with ibrutinib. I migrated them to zanubrutinib. Some of them even had side effects with zanubrutinib, and then we went on to acalabrutinib. But look at, you know, it's the same thing we do with blood pressure medication. We wouldn't be able to do this sort of migration because of side effects if we didn't have all these very effective drugs at our disposal. And we want to take into account, you know, how the patient is presenting, what their genomics show, to be able to make these qualified decisions. And I just want to show you here, you know, some of the data that was also presented in Madrid that spoke about that nasty TP53 mutation. And the take home here is that, in fact, even with these modern drugs, the patients, you know, tend to have shorter progression-free survival if they have the TP53 mutation, but may be better off with a drug such as zanubrutinib when they do, in fact, present with TP53. Now, this is a slide that I don't expect you to memorize, and in fact, not even be able to read. But the kind of detail and forethought that went into this was really the brainchild of Shirley Dessau, who systematically wanted to make sure people understood that if you saw, you know, chemoimmunotherapy, these were your options. If you saw chemoimmunotherapy and a BTK inhibitor, these were your options. And this gives us really the notion that we will selectively, going forward, treat patients, you know, more aware of what they've already seen and how they're presenting. This is all going to be published very soon. I know that, Newt and others are going to probably assemble this, you know, for the membership. And knowing, how things will be, there'll always be a layperson's commentary to go with this. But these have all been accepted for publication, and we're just awaiting for them to actually be physically published. But in due time, you will have this, you know, for your bedtime reading, if you so desire. Let me just say that if somebody is intolerant to a BTK inhibitor, there are two choices. Our, you know, colleague Shayna Sarosiak, who you'll be hearing from shortly, did a very nice study showing that you can actually reduce the dose of ibrutinib if you encounter a side effect. And at the end of the day, in the vast majority of patients, you don't sacrifice response. And many of the patients, the side effect that perhaps triggered the dose reduction don't occur. My other colleague, Mazar Shadman in Seattle, did a very interesting study where he took patients, various types of B-cell malignancies. You'll see Waldenstrom's is sort of outlined there, and it made up about 15% of all the patients in the big cohort. He was able to show that you can actually shift people over if they're having side effects on ibrutinib to zanubrutinib, and in the vast majority of cases, you won't get that side effect, including atrial fibrillation. So this actually, once again, speaks to the fact that why we're blessed as a community to have all these groups investigating the different BTK inhibitors in Waldenstrom's. And of course, you know, to mention my colleague and friend, Jorge Castillo, who last year published this very pivotal study looking at the BCL2 inhibitor. BCL2 is a protein that actually keeps Waldenstrom cells alive. This finding was also first elucidated in our laboratory. And this is a blocker of BCL2. And I think what the exciting data from this was that even though he treated patients only for 2 years and stopped, Patients continued to respond, and in fact, even after being heavily pretreated, most patients had 30 months of their disease being without progression. And the drug worked even in people who had seen a BTK inhibitor, you know, or not. It worked in patients who had the CXCR4 mutation or not. So this does represent, you know, a new and exciting endeavor for treating patients that have seen a BTK inhibitor. But my other friend and colleague, Leah Palumba, you'll notice I have a lot of friends. We have a lot of friends. Also presented this very exciting data on pirtobrutinib. Now, this is also a BTK inhibitor. But the other BTK inhibitors that I talked about, ibrutinib, zanubrutinib, acalabrutinib, they all bind to a unique site on BTK. Pirtobrutinib, on the other hand, binds to alternative sites. And many of the patients who become resistant to one of those other three, the zanu or ibrutinib or acalabrutinib, it's because of a mutation that's introduced at that binding site that they all share. Pirtobrutinib binds at a different site. And as a result, we've seen tremendous activity with this drug in Waldenstrom's. And you see those bars are the reduction for individual patients in their disease. Even if the patient had seen a prior BTK inhibitor like zanubrutinib or ibrutinib or acalabrutinib, they still show tremendous levels of response and even endurance of that response. So, you know, at our center now, we are combining pirtobrutinib with venetoclax, and Jorge Castillo will be leading that effort. And in fact, that study just opened, and we just got drugs, so we're very excited to see that combination go forward. So I'm going to talk now about what Consensus Panel 3, recommended. This was a very interesting panel, and it was made of hardcore scientists as well as clinicians. Most of the other panels were made up of just clinicians. This was led by Dr. Garcia Sanz from Spain, Dr. Varitoni from Italy, and our Dr. Hunter from the Dana-Farber. It was good to have this sort of combined scientific and clinical knowledge, because here the considerations were about what mutations do we care about? How do we test for them? Because it's not easy to test for all these mutations. The take home was that MYD88, CXCR4, TP53 genes should be studied. And even the TP53, status of somebody should be repeated when they present again and require therapy. But they also introduced these other chromosomal abnormalities, 6Q. This is chromosome 6. Q is the long arm. You might remember that chromosomes have a short arm and a long arm. But that long arm gets deleted in about half of all patients with Waldenstrom's. I'll show you in a moment why that's important. And 17P is the short arm of chromosome 17, and this is where TP53 is. So you can get a mutation in TP53, or you can lose a copy of it when you have a deletion in chromosome 17P. It was also important to keep in mind that the kind of testing that we use to pick up these mutations can have its faults. And I'm going to show you in just a moment one of those studies. And lastly, when you're getting these mutations worked up, make sure you're going to a specialized center that has the appropriate diagnostic, workup, available to determine these mutations. Let me say to you why chromosome 6Q is so important. Like I said, half of all Waldenstrom patients are missing at least one copy of chromosome 6Q. And look at all the things that sit on this chromosome. These are regulators of BTK, regulators of BCL2, and regulators of NF-kappa-B, which is the powerful pro-survival signaling molecule. So if you're taking out the regulators, that means that the brakes are gone, and any kind of signaling that occurs for these molecules goes on unabated. And that's why chromosome 6Q is entering into our, needs list. When it comes to MYD88 and CXCR4, be very careful, because a lot of people who come to our clinic often come in and say, well, I didn't have the MYD88 mutation. And then, you start looking and seeing how they were tested. Or they come in saying, I don't have the CXCR4 mutation. And you look once again at how they've been tested. Many centers out there use, PCR. It's a very, very, detailed molecular analysis for MYD88. That's our reference. You can really pick up MYD88 mutations when you use PCR. But some centers use next-generation sequencing. It's a different platform, but it's not as sensitive. And in fact, you miss out on one out of three patients who actually have the MYD88 mutation, especially those patients that have low-burden disease. Look at CXCR4, on the other hand. When you use next-generation sequencing, you're missing 2 out of 3 people that actually have CXCR4. And again, it tends to be people that have the low burden of disease. So the type of testing platform that's used is just as important as testing for these mutations. The next panel was actually one which I think you'll find very interesting, and it may be even inspiring. This was a panel that I led along with my colleague in Italy, Alessandra Tedeschi, and my other colleague, Roger Owen, in the UK. Roger and I had previously published on the response criteria. This panel was tasked with updating how we go about diagnosing Waldenstrom and also how do we know how a patient is responding. And these were the key things that came out of this diagnostic update. First things first, when you look around at, different ways of diagnosing Waldenstrom, you'll see some of the older literature alluding to the fact that you don't have Waldenstrom's unless 10% of your bone marrow is actually impacted. That really is a flawed, argument, because these numbers were taken off, just arbitrarily. There is no literature to back them up. This delineated patients that had the earlier precursor disease to Waldenstrom called MGUS, monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. I'll show you in just a moment why that's an important distinction to keep in mind. And also patients that have that early, IgM monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance, there appears now to be two families, one that's destined to be Waldenstrom, one that's destined to be myeloma. And so it is important to separate those out based on the underlying genomic and morphological characterizations. I want to first talk about why the 10% cutoff is problematic. This was a study that I published back now 14 years ago. And in fact, what you see here is that when you look at the bone marrow involvement of patients, which is depicted on the chart A and B and C, what you see is that patients can be very anemic, symptomatic, have very high IgM levels requiring therapy, even if their bone marrow involvement is only 10%. And so this is why having a sort of 10% cutoff didn't make any sense. And in fact, when you look at the different trials that supported approval of drugs like ibrutinib and zanubrutinib, and these were, patients that were treatment naive, many of them actually had less than 10% bone marrow involvement and yet required therapy and took part in these studies. And even when you look at the drug studies that enabled the NCCN to adopt all these new drugs for Waldenstrom, you'll see that, many of these patients had, IgM, had, bone marrow involvement of less than 10%. And even, IgMs less than 3,000, which were also part of these old criteria. So going forward, the criteria continue to be that if there's any evidence of bone marrow involvement and irrespective of the IgM level, that does constitute Waldenstrom's. Why that's important is because insurers, will look back and say, yeah, he doesn't have Waldenstrom or she doesn't have Waldenstrom. We're not going to pay for these drugs. And it's a problematic, problem when you start arguing around definitions and the need to care for patients with this disease. I also mentioned to you that there are these different entities of IgM MGUS. One that has only plasma cells, those look like they're, bound because of their genomics to become myeloma. We don't want that confused with patients who have the B cell type of IgM MGUS. That is the type that typically evolves into Waldenstrom, which is why this clarification was very important. Now, this is the part some of you may like a lot, and that is that at present, when we do our response criteria for Waldenstrom's, it can be complicated, and many of you who participated on clinical trials know that. Not only do we measure your IgM, but we require you every 3 months to report for a CAT scan. How about no CAT scans? And that's what we looked at, and we did this in a very scientific way. This was also enabled because of the Aspen study, and we're very grateful to Beijing for providing us this data. So there were the standard criteria, which were the old criteria, where we had to see, a reduction in lymph nodes if you had them. So that meant getting you scanned every 3 months. And we also, you know, to validate that you had, you know, some of these deeper responses, we had to see that all the lymph nodes went away. Otherwise, we didn't call you a VGPR, a very good responder. And then we moved to the modified criteria, which came with the sixth international workshop. And there we said, we still want you scanned, but we're going to monitor the reduction in your lymph nodes. And now, with the data set that we have available, we see, in fact, that just looking at lymph node reduction doesn't mean much, that the patients and their categorical responses and even the amount of time that their disease remains in check appears to be similar across all these three response criteria. So going forward, what it'll mean is that we won't have to scan people, and a lot of people don't want to be scanned because of radiation exposure, the inconvenience, the cost. For people who are doing these clinical trials, it means less, tediousness to the study being administered, the costs, and to pharmaceutical companies also, you know, getting rid of having to do these repeat CT scans is not necessary. However, if you do achieve a complete response and you did have lymph nodes at the beginning that were, or spleen that was elevated or, you know, disease outside of the bone marrow, you still have to have a CAT scan, but that's for people that achieve a complete response. These are the new simplified response criteria, and as I said, I think they really will change the way we go about assessing disease benefit. Consensus panel 5, I'm gonna be very brief on. Andy Brannigan did a great job yesterday talking about COVID management in patients with Waldenstrom's. This consensus panel was led by a wonderful friend and colleague, Evangelos Terpos from Greece, Andy Brannigan, but also Veronique LeBlond, who is really a stalwart in Waldenstrom's research. And what they were tasked with is to provide, you know, detailed recommendations on, you know, prophylaxis as well as management of individuals with Waldenstrom who may be exposed to COVID. Remember Andy's message yesterday, boosters do count, vaccinations count, boosters do count. They really do bring up those titers. He also talked to you about Paxlovid, that, you know, if you have, you know, exposure, try to get on Paxlovid as soon as possible. Of course, you know, get tested and, you know, get on Paxlovid as soon as possible. And he also mentioned to you about the influenza vaccine. This panel also covered the fact that double dose of the influenza vaccine might also lead to a more robust, you know, prevention of the flu. I'll go on to consensus panel 6. I'll be brief here again. This has to do with patients who have amyloidosis. Some of you may not be familiar with what amyloidosis is. The best way to explain it is chewing gum. Do you? Some of you may have had kids who, you know, once in a while they'd get chewing gum stuck in their hair. I certainly had it. And you know how difficult it is to get, you know, chewing gum out of someone's hair. Well, think about organs, you know, in our body where you make the amyloid protein. Amyloid is, you know, part of that IgM. And when that gets into organs, it can cause a lot of problems. It can cause heart failure. It can cause neuropathy. This panel, led by Dr. Giampaolo Merlini, who is the utmost, you know, authority in amyloid. We also are blessed to have Maury Gertz as well as an amyloid expert. Shayna Sarosiak, who you'll be hearing from shortly, who trained at BU at one of the best amyloid centers in the United States, and Monique Minima, similarly, you know, an expert in amyloid. They all came together with a very distinguished international panel, and they came up with very specific recommendations on how to work somebody up if they have amyloid, and even, you know, the treatment. And following response using the light chains, the light chain component to be able to assess response. And so their key points in terms of how to manage patients with amyloid or suspected amyloid are detailed here. I'll skip over this because, again, they'll be published and I don't want to sort of beleaguer, you know, their recommendations. I will come to a conclusion here by talking about consensus panel 7. This was actually a fantastic panel, because it was tasked with giving us the priorities for what we should be doing for clinical trials. There are a lot of drugs out there right now. In fact, there's probably as many drugs as there are Waldenstrom patients. So with this in mind, how do we prioritize what we should be studying? And if we're studying this and doing these, you know, comparative trials, big trials, what do we compare? What's going to be our, you know, standard of care? You know, should it be bendamustine? Should it be a BTK inhibitor? This is why this was such an important panel. And here, Constantine Tam from Australia, who also led the Aspen study, Prashant Kapoor, who I know all of you know quite well from the Mayo, and MJ Kirsten from the Netherlands, led this effort. It was a very detailed report. You'll see, again, a lot of experts from, you know, throughout the US, Asia, Europe, as well as Australia, took place in this. And this is just a slide. It's meant to be small, so you can't read it. Of all the trials that are ongoing now, that include Waldenstrom. It's a lot of them. You know, I only had so much space to put all of them on, so hence the condensed version. And these are the ones that industry is supporting. So these are ones led by investigators that they've, you know, their own institutions. They're leading these concepts. These are the ones, you know, sponsored by industry. The bottom line is a lot of trials. Everybody wants to see what their favorite drug would do for Waldenstrom. But part of our effort here is to try to cone down which are the ones that really count. This is what this consensus panel did. And not only that, they also made a couple of mentions here that were important, that maybe to prioritize fixed duration, you know, instead of, you know, endless or continuous therapy. To make sure that we account for the molecular diagnostics, MYD88, CXCR4, TP53, to utilize some backbones that many of us, you know, accept, like the bendamustine Rituxan for chemoimmunotherapy, but also looking at different endpoints than we're used to. Sometimes, you know, we stop somebody's participation on a trial when their IgM has gone up, you know, there has to be a minimum increase of 25% or 500. A lot of people will meet that threshold and will stop therapy, but they're still benefiting from the therapy. So why not use or evaluate other endpoints, such as time to next therapy, TTNT, which means to evaluate, you know, the benefit of a drug until you require another drug. And so these are the sort of endpoints that were put in to place. As I conclude here, I just want to show you some of my favorite slides. You know, we were quite blessed at this meeting to honor some, you know, real heroes of Waldenstrom. These were the Robert A. Kyle Award winners for significant contributions to Waldenstrom's. This included Ramon Garcia Sanz, Jorge Castillo, as well as Steve Ansel. We actually awarded three awards. Typically, we do one, but the last workshop took place 4 years earlier because of COVID. And there were just so many people we needed to catch up on, you know, honoring. We also had the opportunity to give out the very prestigious Jan Gosta Waldenstrom Awards. These are for a lifetime of contributions to Waldenstrom. Pictured here in the center is my colleague Christian Buske from Germany, who you will be hearing from. He was honored with one of these awards. You see Ken Anderson, Veronique LeBlond, and Eva Kimby, who were previous award recipients, giving actually Christian his award. And we also had the opportunity to honor Irene Gobriel for all her work, particularly with precursor diseases and also for our understanding of Waldenstrom. She was a recipient of one of these Jan Gosta Waldenstrom Awards. And finally, we also honored Jesus San Miguel, who is really a giant. You may not know his name, but all the contributions that he's made to Waldenstrom are tremendous, but also for his contributions to multiple myeloma. This actually was one of my favorite slides. This was a coup for women. These are the awardees who got the Bing Humanitarian Awards. We had the opportunity to honor Mary McMaster from the NIH. We honored Shirley Dessau from the UK, but also Judy Trotman from Australia. And the awards were presented by Chris Patterson, a prior recipient, along with Ranjana Advani. And also, you know, present there was Karen Lee Sobel. Was a very, very distinguished author and somebody who's done a lot for our cause. I think as I show you this last slide, I want to tell you why I'm excited. I'm excited because of the next generation of investigators. There were a lot of young people who had the opportunity to present at the meeting. We honored 10 young investigators. And these individuals received the IWMF's Young Investigator Award, and you can see that Newt was present there for these awards. I'm only going to show you one slide, because if I show you everyone, it's a lot of slides. But just to tell you, it's really our hope in them as the next generation to carry on all the successes that we've been able to accomplish together. And with that, I will stop. And thank you so much for your kind attention and support. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Tran, for this amazing and comprehensive presentation. We have about 20 minutes right now for you to take questions from the audience. Audience members with questions for... Hey, you got to come back. Oh, okay. You can have water. Audience members with questions for Dr. Tran, please line up for the microphones in the aisles. And you're welcome to grab a disposable microphone cover located next to the microphone stand.
Well, thank you. Oh, thank you, dear. That's okay. Thank you. No, I thought Glenn was giving me the right to exit here. Happy to take questions. And the lights are very strong and blinding, so I'll just point if it's okay.
Okay, no, that's fine. So I found it very interesting, your discussion on wild type, because supposedly I am wild type.
Actually,
but
is it possible to turn off the lights so we're not like the deer?
No. I should have brought my sunglasses then. But please, go on with your question.
Okay, so anyways, about wild type. So supposedly I'm wild type, though I did see Dr. Castillo, and he liked where my lab did it, but we put it on the back burner. But I found it very interesting about, should someone that's wild type get retested because of the drugs coming out? And if, let's say, they truly are wild type, then what drugs would, the P drug,
pirtobrutinib.
That's kind of that where...
No, I think... individuals should be critically assessed for how they were tested. You know, what their burden of disease was. If it was low, that may have been a confounding factor why they were, they were unable to be detected for MYD88. The chances that you have MYD88 mutation, though, are between 95 and 97%. But it's really identifying the people that truly don't have it, because, we'll handle them different. We may offer them zanubrutinib or bortezomib or bendamustine, because we know that this population benefits with these drugs. And we did all the genomic sequencing for people that have no MYD88 mutations. It turns out they're mutations that are below BTK and sort of that electrical diagram of how these cells grow and survive. And there are other mutations that are important that we're looking to drug. And that's why, as we go forward, knowing somebody's real MYD88 status is important. Please.
So I fall into the very small percentage of those that was diagnosed with the TP53 aberration before I had started any treatment. My pathology report says TP53 deletion. So I guess, is that the same as a 17P deletion? And do you see differences in terms of efficacy from BTK inhibitors on deletion versus mutation?
Yeah, I wish I could answer that question. We really have very limited knowledge, with how these different classes of TP53 mutations, operate in Waldenstrom's. But we do have experience from CLL as well as myeloma that having a deletion in 17P is also bad, like TP53. When you look at TP53 mutations, you also want to look at the ones that affect the DNA binding, domain. It's a special domain. And those are the ones that are the bad actors. So even the type of TP53 mutation is very important.
Okay.
But going forward, I think it is very important for people that have been previously treated to have that TP53 mutation testing done. I'll keep going back and forth here.
Okay.
Eileen,
please. I've been on zanubrutinib now for about 4 years.
Uh-huh.
And other than the initial, I have no fingernails and I bruise easily, et cetera, I really had very few, if any, side effects. But then suddenly at about 3.5 years, I developed pretty nasty sores on my tongue. And now that you're talking about BTK mutations, I'm starting to wonder, we haven't seen zanubrutinib over the long term very much. So does this mean I may no longer respond to it after a while?
It probably has nothing to do with the type of response. You know, we saw even in our ibrutinib trial, we had sores in the mouth in a small number of patients. I mean, it's fairly uncommon. So this could be just a side effect of the BTK inhibitor.
After 3.5 years.
Yeah. No, there were a lot of people who got them very, late in their course. There were other drugs even before this that, we used that had mouth sores all the time. We would give our patients Miracle Wash to sort of swish and spit. But the answer to you might be either a switch or a decrease in a dose of the zanubrutinib. We're going to encounter speed bumps with every drug.
Right.
But it's wonderful that you've had a long response.
Interestingly, we did take a break for a month, and after 3 days, they were gone.
Yeah.
And then after that month, I went back on one pill a day, and after 3 days, they were back.
And they're back, yeah.
Yeah.
And this is where, Eileen, a switchover might be, a way to think about managing. And we do switchovers now with all these different BTK inhibitors.
Hi. I've been on ibrutinib pretty successfully for 4+ years. And yet I'm hearing you say that the profiles of how zanubrutinib is working are basically better. Is there an advantage to switch? Do you recommend switching when things are going along smoothly?
No.
Okay.
When things are going along smoothly, you just let it.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
I think there's very strong consensus on this, that if you're doing well, that you stay on course, whether that's if you're on Zanu or if you're on ibrutinib. But if there's side effects, it's a different story. The one area that should be clarified is if you're progressing, if your disease is progressing on one of these covalent BTK inhibitors, ibrutinib, zanubrutinib, or acalabrutinib, that it's unlikely that switching to a different BTK inhibitor of that class, the covalent class, is going to make a difference. So that's different.
Sense.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Of course. Please.
Hi. I've always been curious about the difference when I look at all these treatment charts as to time to progression. And often it's not very long. Sometimes it is. Or time to next treatment. Which measurement should you look at? I mean, I had only like a year to the next progression, but I had 10 years to next treatment.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Which is more important?
Well, they're both important. I mean, they're assessing different values of therapy. But in a disease like ours with Waldenstrom's, sometimes the progression can be very, very slow. You might meet a checkpoint that says, you've met criteria for progression. But let me give you an example. Somebody who starts off with an IgM of 10,000, they drop down to 500, right, with that therapy. And then, the IgM is climbing up. When they hit 1,000, they've already met the criteria that they're progressing. But look at the difference, 10,000, 1,000, they've already made the criteria that they've progressed, and we'll report them out as progressors, and in fact, most trials will say that you come off therapy now. But look at the sort of time that can go by before you really need a second therapy. And if you stop the BTK inhibitor as an example, that disease will just come right back. It'll boomerang. We call that the rebound. So there is, this sort of notion that we ought to be looking at these secondary endpoints to measure, activity of these medications.
Thanks.
I think you were next, please.
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Trion. I have a question from our virtual audience.
Okay.
The question is, regarding BTK inhibitor side effects, why not start off at a lower dose and go up if a more robust response is necessary?
Yeah, that's a great question. And, to be honest, we don't have the correct answer. But I want to say something that when we, determine these dosings of the different drugs, the sort of parameters that were used were to see, could we shut off BTK? And it turns out that some of these drugs actually have other targets, too. In the case of ibrutinib, it also shuts down HCK. I talked about this during the donor lunch earlier. Also, the environment, the bone marrow environment, plays a role in how these cells grow. And many of the cells that help the Waldenstrom cells grow also have BTK and HCK. So when you're thinking about dosing, I think it is really important to start off with the approved drug dose. If the patient encounters, you know, toxicity, then you can start, you know, rolling back therapy. But to me, that's the far better way to control disease than inching up and missing the opportunity to control disease from the get-go.
Thank you.
Please. Yeah, my question is about genetic testing. I went back to the Bing Center way back in 2013, and I was tested for the MYD88 mutation, which I had, but you weren't testing yet for the CXCR4. That came shortly afterwards, so I don't know whether I have that or not. And I've heard over the years a lot about CXCR4, and I don't know whether I haven't been paying attention, but this is the first I've heard about TP53, which seems very important, especially since the only time I was treated it was with chemotherapy. So my question is, what are you testing for routinely in your genetic testing now? Is it MYD88, CXCR4, and TP53? And do you test for other mutations when you do your genetic testing?
Yeah, so keep in mind that these consensus panels are about to be published. So this sort of reflects the community's conscious as to how we should go about managing patients prospectively. But I think MYD88 and CXCR4 for newly diagnosed patients is a good idea. The chances that you have a TP53 when you're newly diagnosed is fairly small. I think that was also validated by the Aspen data. That becomes even more important when somebody has been previously treated, and then I think it is really important to keep in mind, because at least the BTK inhibitor choice becomes, you know, more important, that if you have the TP53, a BTK inhibitor might be the more sensible therapy to embark on.
Thanks very much. Good. Yeah. Good job. Now you get to the water.